Hi, my name is Lynn Kunstman. I'm a master gardener with Jackson County Master Gardener Association. And the first garden on our tour this morning is the Sturtevant Armstrong Garden. Vicki Sturtevant and Alan Armstrong moved to this property almost 40 years ago. The Ashland hillside was overly shady and had poor soil. They've transformed this over the years to a flourishing landscape, which combines a wide variety of natives with berries, vegetables, and other landscape plants. Welcome to their garden.
Good morning, my name's Candy Steely, and these are my hosts here, Alan Armstrong and Vicki Sturtevant, and they are in Ashland with a native garden tour, and they have many beautiful natives and ornamentals and edibles. And we'd like to start with, how is it that you came about liking the native gardens so much and plants?
Well, when we moved in here more than 30 years ago, we found a house that didn't have much sunlight. It's all here at the front of the property.
Right.
And this was all lawn, pretty old-fashioned ornamentals and so on. Very soon after, we bought the lot behind us, which is a forested lot with a lot of native plants. And so we got interested partly because we wanted to have a landscaping down here that would connect with the back of the house more, but it was also because we spent a lot of time in Southern Oregon outdoors and we kept seeing plants that we love, and we wanted to import them to this site when we could.
We've done a beautiful job mixing them in with everything and making it look very natural. Would you like to take us on a tour of showing us all your little beautiful plants here?
Oh, sure. You want to start, Vicki?
No, you start.
Okay. Well, this is one of our favorite kinds of plants. Mm-hmm. It's a native penstemon, and we have lots of them, and it's a changing cast over the years, but they're really beautiful flowers and underused, I think.
Yes.
There are a couple more natives here. This is a Lewisia. Those grow up in the mountains. A little dagger pod. We see those up at Pilot Rock a lot. And these little guys are sickle leafed onions. There are lots of beautiful onions in the mountains around here, too. Mm-hmm. These haven't quite bloomed yet, but
they
will
edible?
Pretty soon. I don't honestly know. I've never tried it.
Mm-hmm. Maybe you shouldn't.
But and all of these things, once we took the lawn out and put the sidewalk in here, we had a little drop off here that's perfect for these mountain rocky plants. They like good drainage in soil that has a lot of rock in it. Mm-hmm. So it's turned out to be a wonderful place to grow those. Now we're in the side yard. You probably notice here as we walk around that we mix up native plants with garden plants and ornamentals. And this is a good example here with our little spring garden of lettuce and kale and so on. And we have a little native azure penstemon here tucked into the corner of it. And over here, lots of berries, blueberries, marionberries, and so on. But here too, these little rock walls make handy spots for things like this little Lewisia. From here, I think we can move up the driveway to some of the other native plants. On the way, hard to see over here, but a really nice leopard lily that you need it. In the back, leopard lilies. Took us a while to find the right place for those. They've moved around a lot, but now they've really taken off. And there's a smaller cousin of it, Wiggins lily, that we grew from seed that's finally catching hold right here. Tiny little guy, but both beautiful flowers. And once you get them going, pretty easy to grow.
This Lewisia is shouting out for attention.
Yeah, those are really beautiful rock plants, and they hang in there for a long time. Another one of our success stories. This is an area that was really hard for us to grow things in at the edge of the driveway because it was really soggy in the winter, and then it would dry out and get pretty hot in the summer. And we tried all kinds of other plants, gauras, and what were some of the other ones we had here? Vicki, verbenas and so on. They never really quite looked good. But then we realized that there were some native plants that thrived in conditions like that. and we sort of bit by bit got those in here. So we have these, I don't even know how to pronounce this, they're triple lilies, but some people call them tritellias, other people call them tritillaeas. Anyway, this is what they are. They'll have beautiful flowers later on. But they're happy as clams here in this little spot. And the same thing happened over here, where we have a combination of checker mallows, these broadleaf plants here, which have been expanding and reseeding and taking over the place. But these camases that we also planted at the same time seem to be able to get along with them. Okay, so this one in the back is called the greater camas. It's taller. And then these little guys in front are ordinary camases, the kind that Lewis and Clark ate on their expedition.
Oh, well, interesting.
But they're very happy there.
And also in here are grass widows, which you see on the top of Pilot Rock, well, near the top of Pilot Rock and the Table Rocks. So those are really beautiful.
Yes.
Form a nice meadow.
And I think Vicki is going to show you one of her favorite shrubs.
Well, I spend a lot of time with this shrub because I have to prune it severely every year because it's a very enthusiastic Lonicera. It's also known as black honeysuckle.
It's a
twin berry. And here you'll see yellow flowers that are just starting out, and it will be covered with yellow flowers that the hummingbirds really like. And it flowered at the end of the summer as well, and I was surprised to see the humming there when it has so many other places to go. We also have another Lonicera, which is a climbing plant that you see on Table Rock a lot. And it's also called orange honeysuckle. And it's quite beautiful when it grows up into the trees or on a fence. This is the transition to the more heavily shaded part of our yard, which has different kinds of challenges. You'll see that we've used ferns a lot. So we have sword ferns throughout this area. And we have a couple of ferns that are still coming up here, cinnamon ferns and deer ferns, maidenhair ferns, which our kids used to call the old lady's hand ferns. I bought this trillium in Eugene many years ago, and it comes up faithfully every year. It wasn't until this year that Alan looked at it and discovered that it's an albidum. It's got a different kind of flower than the trillium that we often see in the woods.
We're up at the pond now at the edge of the woods, where we still have a mix of native plants and other kinds of things. The marsh marigolds are the yellow-flowered plants around the pond. The ones that we usually see up on Mount Ashland actually have white flowers at higher elevations, but these are really pretty plants. And then you have some lobelias over here. Monkey flowers that are just coming up. There's several kinds of those. Some little red ones over here, not blooming yet. This is an oddball native plant called a Boitinia, but it's just barely getting started too. But it will have interesting flowers later on. Up to the left, beyond the garden bench is a red flowering currant, which is a really, really admirable garden shrub. It has beautiful red pink flowers and it's easy to grow. Would recommend it strongly to anyone. We also have a native columbine just beneath it there along the side of the stream.
Many of you have probably seen this plant at the coast. This is salal, and it grows here in the shade and enjoys being watered. And this is one of my favorite plants. It's the Smith's fairy bell. And you see that when you're hiking in the Ortsentaud Woods. It has beautiful little white flowers that dangle from there. And similar to this is the Smilacina, which will grow anywhere that you let it. We have tried a number of little wildflowers in this garden, sometimes with success and sometimes with less. Twin flower, as opposed to twin berry, has grown here. But this is wintergreen, which is not native. This is Vancouveria, which is inside-out plant that has pretty little upside-down, inside-out flowers. And you may recognize the bleeding heart, the Dicentra. And this, we'll have more of this as the season goes on, as we will with the Vancouveria. This is some native ginger. And some more fern. Alan and I were, and are, fond of species rhododendrons and would go up to Seattle to the Species Rhododendron Society and so forth to buy these plants. And it's, they are not hybridized, so they're much trickier to grow in the sense that their flowers are smaller and sometimes they die. So it was a natural progression for us to move from the species non-hybridized rhododendrons to the native plants, rather than having a hybridized plant that you can order through a catalog or at your local nursery. We started putting native shrubs up there. So we have a wax myrtle, we have Garia, Fumati, and we have a number of other shrubs up at the top. Some more spirea and holodiscus and more currant. We have this challenge with these banks, but some things like ceanothus and huckleberry like growing on them. We also have a high bush cranberry that has beautiful flowers in the spring and turns a nice red color in the fall. So we have planted some more native shrubs on this bank. This one at the bottom is a Philadelphus, and you see that in the Ortsentaud Woods. And I tried pruning it because it wants to grow up, and I wanted it to be a nice base shrub. But if you've seen it in the wild, that's the way it wants to grow, and that's the way that this one grows, along with nine bark and holodiscus and more spirea and more some other shrubs that are up there. Over the years, we found that our species rhododendrons are dying with the climate change. And so we've switched to some more plants that are from Northern California and Southern Oregon. This is a spice bush that we were encouraged at Southern Oregon Nursery to try, and it has wonderful flowers and seed pods and turns a beautiful color in the fall. This is a late flowering, these are native azaleas, and this is a very old one that we just moved here. This is a younger one, and the native azaleas grow quite well in this area.
Well, we've walked down the lawn, downhill, and we're back in the sun again at the front of the house. This is the place that a lot of sun-loving natives like to be. We have a particular fondness for penstemons, native wildflowers, so we have a big long row of them here that we've put in. They all like the same kind of soil, sort of gravelly, stony soil. So we put them in here along the way. Penstemon pinifolia, this is a Rocky Mountain one. This little plant is a skyrocket. You'll see those up on Mount Ashland. And we've got some others going down the way here, all the way out to that Davidson penstemon on the corner. And another little dagger pod here. They're rewarding plants to grow. They don't always live a long time, but it's always an excuse to get another one to replace the old ones with. Oh, I almost forgot our granddaughter's favorite plant. Her name is Alice, and this is a plant called Alice's Fleabane, which you'd find on Mount Ashland, a really pretty plant. This is another fleabane here, the showy fleabane. It's got a beautiful purple flower.
So what would you give the guidance and lessons for people who are wanting to include natives in their garden? Is there any tips about what you would do?
Well, I think we do this because we love the plants, and we see them hiking and camping and kayaking out in the woods, and I'd encourage other people to try as well. We think of this as a sort of fun experiment, trying to see what will grow in the yard here. And one of the best pieces of advice I think I could give is that when you are out hiking, seeing these plants in the wild, pay attention. See where they're growing, what kind of soil, what kind of sun, what kind of water conditions, and that will give you the best chance of succeeding home. But it's still going to be a trial and error experiment,
right.
But well worth it, well worth it.
Well, you've done a wonderful job here. This has been so enjoyable, and we thank you so much, both of you, for your hosting this Native